name is Hyunjae Kim. I went to UCSD as an undergrad major in bioengineering, which is here. And then I'm going to be pursuing a master's degree in bioengineering here at the same university, graduate school. It's like an interdisciplinary field that integrates sort of elements of many different subjects, including chemistry, physics, mathematics, biology for sure, and probably some of electronics as well, mechanics. So basically anything as applied to biology, physics, chemistry, mathematics as applied to biology. The engineering itself is dedicated to solving problems for us to improve upon the efficiency of machines or whatever that there is. So basically the bioengineering is to sort of investigate the biological phenomena that happen throughout your body, and then hopefully sort of in a quantitative sense, you make a quantitative formulation of what's going on in your body, and then sort of applying those concepts or studies in a way that contribute to the human health. So I mean, actually one of the reasons why I personally chose bioengineering was because, I mean, I've been interested in all the, you know, sort of all this cutting edge stuff that go on in the field of biology, but I also had an interest in mathematics and physics, sort of the mathematical quantitative aspects of biology. So I just didn't want to do sort of straightforward biology for the rest of my life. So I kind of wanted to have a taste of both biology and mathematics. And if you're particularly interested in, I guess, like, I don't know, like medical instrumentation or like stem cell engineering, which is quite a popular subfield within bioengineering these days. And yeah, I guess that those are, if one of the students are interested in those, then definitely pursue bioengineering. But one thing that I want to kind of point out is that since bioengineering is so is so broad, the field itself, that you don't have to be like bioengineering in order to be a bioengineer. You can have degrees in like general biology or other traditional fields of engineering, because bioengineering is a relatively new field. So you can have your degree established in some other fields, and you just gotta need a little bit of knowledge in biology and sort of apply those knowledge that you acquire from your own particular field and integrate it, sort of combine it with a little bit of like theoretical knowledge you gain from biology. And boom, there's like hybrid between those two, like knowledge from those two different fields, and there is bioengineering. So the field itself is really broad, I should say, yeah. So some of the course requirements, as required by the curriculum of bioengineering major here at UCSD, a lot of the courses overlap with those course requirements for medical schools. So a lot of students from my major actually choose to pursue medical degrees later on once graduating. And sort of the half of the population, the graduate population, actually goes into, I guess like 30% goes into industry, and probably 20% actually pursue a graduate degree in bioengineering, not medical school, but like graduate school, not professional schools. And like probably like 5% of the graduates actually goes into like a totally radically different field, like law school or whatever. So if you want to kind of want to work in the industry like for the rest of your life, rather than kind of sticking in an office and conduct research forever, then master's would be a good option, because it's sort of linked, it serves as a link between school and industry. Like master's, these days, I'm pretty sure these days master's education is considered industrial work experience by a lot of companies. So if the duration of your master's degree is typically either 1 or 2 years, like some of those students accelerating and, you know, in their studies actually finish within a year, but regularly the average, you know, duration is 2 years. say if you work, if you study for 2 years, then those years are not only considered as part of your academic education, but also consider work experiences. So you don't have to do like full on 5 years of 5 or 6 years of PhD. You can just have 2 years of master's education, which is not much different from undergrad education, other than the fact that you have to write a thesis. Or there are two different tracks available within the master's. One is called Master of Engineering. The other is called Master of Science. Master of Engineering is for students who are the undergrads who just want to take additional, like more difficult graduate level courses and go straight into industry. And the Master of Science is a non-terminal degree. What I mean by that is that you can easily continue on the PhD. Not, I shouldn't say the word easily, but you can kind of naturally continue on the PhD once finishing the master's thesis. And for the Master of Science, you have to write a dissertation, unlike in Master of Engineering, where you're just only required to take courses. So if you are one of those students who are kind of torn between working in the industry or doing a PhD and to become a professor and actually conduct research as a researcher, like in academia settings, then definitely choose Master of Science. But if you're like 100% sure that you want to do work in the industry, then a lot of people go towards Master of Engineering, which is only a year long program. So I'm kind of in that boat. Well, I mean, yeah, like I'm currently doing Master of Science, which is for 2 year for 2 year long program. And I'm in that boat where I'm either I want to sort of go out in the industry once I graduate, or want to continue on to PhD. Even though these days I'm geared towards, getting a PhD degree and going into the industry later on. So there are three different tracks within undergrad bioengineering major. One called bioengineering, just bioengineering. The second being biotechnology. Third being bioinformatics. And the track from which I graduated is just a regular bioengineering. It had a heavy emphasis, like specialization on medical instrumentation, biomedical imaging, and any sort of courses related to like in relation to mechanical, like electronics aspects of the upsetting research. So I didn't do much of a biotechnological studies, as in like stem cell engineering. Bioengineering at UCSD in particular is pretty, I mean, it's generally bioengineering is pretty tough field in terms of workload. A lot of homework, like there's like a homework every single week, no doubt about it, for every single bioengineering course. And there are a lot of quizzes and tests as well, because of the nature of it being an engineering class. And then, it's very math involved, like fundamental science involved. So half of your studying will be just all about memorization, and the other half of the studying will be actually utilizing your mathematical knowledge to solve complicated problems. So that's how sort of the nature of, as far as the nature of coursework goes, that's how I can describe it. A lot of students are here, in my experience, were under a lot of pressure because the competition is really cutthroat. It's just a lot of like insanely like hardcore, like persistent students are all packed in, concentrated within this major. So they try to outcompete each other a lot. Even though there are some rooms for collaboration, still grade assignment is based on competition. The fittest survives, right? So I guess one of my favorite classes was medical instrumentation course, in which I had to design a circuit, analyze and design a circuit, and then sort of learn how to apply that to different biological environments, mostly humans. And that has to do with a fascinating area of research in neural implants, where they design like a neural, like an implant with electronic like chips on it, basically, and then they kind of apply it to an area of neural degeneration, like if your brain cells are not, like if your neuronal cells, because neural cells are not self-renewing, which means that once they're damaged, then they're pretty much done for life. So with those sort of special neural implants fixed in place, they could generate some sort of electric signals to stimulate those neuronal activities. There was a minimal success, as far as I know, up to this point, but there has been a consistent progress in that, enlist. So there will be a lot of potentials in that field as well. So, I mean, a lot of the circuit analysis and designs were directly pertained to those like neural implants, even though they're really basic circuits that I had to deal with. And another favorite, another interesting class was on just biomedical imaging. So if you look at, for example, if you're a high school student, you just flip through like biology textbooks and then you find all these cool pictures of membrane, like cellular signaling pathways or whatever, how the genes are transcribed. And you see like a whole bunch of these weird pictures. And a lot of students are actually take them for granted. You know, they would probably think that, oh, as long as you just, you know, get a sample of cells and kind of like observe it under a microscope, you should be able to see all of these pictures, you know, as if it's a breeze. But a lot of pictures, those pictures are, I should say, the results of years and years of imaging technology, where, for example, this video camera that films me, it has a lot into it other than its mere appearance. It's not just a piece of plastic. It has electronics, little bit of, you know, devices in it that kind of work in a coherent way to deliver a picture. So the biomedical imaging class that I took was it looked at different modalities of microscope, like light microscopy and electron microscopy and all those different kinds of microscopy, and how those how each of those modality has its own advantage or disadvantage, and how it was originally developed, and then what concepts that were those development was based on. And I started to appreciate how difficult it is to get those micron or nanoscale images that you can easily find in your textbooks. And I mean, all this, any biological research is just not possible without this imaging technology. So I mean, it was just so fascinating to me, yeah, the whole idea. Any mathematics and like basic science courses should definitely are actually essential to be successful in this major. So I personally took all the AP mathematics, AP calculus, and AP biology, AP chemistry, all those AP courses in mathematics and science. So those courses prepare me pretty well, at least for the lower division courses, because it's sort of repeating of what you actually learned in high school, and with just a little more, enhanced difficulty, basically. So those AP courses are actually they're targeted for freshmen college students, right? So what you learn from AP classes are pretty much likely to be what you would actually expect to learn as a freshman in college. So those are pretty good preparation for undergrad coursework. And so just any, like I just said, mathematics, like AP courses would definitely be preferred to just any or honors or regular level courses. There are three considerations that need to be accounted for when you consider education. So One is what you're really, truly passionate about. The second thing is what you're good at. Third thing is how marketable your degree will be, meaning whether you'll be able to make good money with what you do. So those three are key considerations, I should say, as a, you know, your interests, talent, and money. So it's sort of like diet, right? If you only prefer to eat what you like, it's only gonna result in malnutrition. So I guess the same principle applies to education as well. So people say just do what you want, just do, you know, mathematics, science, they're all bullshit. So like if you're not skilled enough, if you're not smart enough, those are not your things. But I think challenging yourself and sort of changing your interest, changing your weakness into one of your strengths is a great success in itself. So first of all, just find your interests and then possibly consider whether you will be good at those things that you've been thinking that you're weak in. And that's where the money and talent aspects come into play. Say you're good at something, but you don't like it. And there's another thing that you are not good at, but you like. And the third factor comes into play. Then if you're to choose between the two, which one would give you more money? It's not possible to find a perfect balance, like perfect triangle where it's something you like, something you're good at, and can make good money out of. But just find a point where those factors are compromised.